I'm just on my way to Hull City Centre to meet with a Spanish girl. The other day I was just thinking about how I've been back in Hull for like 3 weeks now, and not only am I starting to miss speaking in Spanish a little bit, but also I'm kind of eager to maintain what I've spent the past 5 years of my life like trying really hard to learn. So just out of curiosity, I did a quick online search to see if there were anybody in Hull who wanted to practice English in exchange for Spanish. No expectations, and anyway, I found a girl who's just moved here from Spain literally last week, so I sent her a message and we've agreed to meet in the city centre. I'm just on my way over there now.
A language exchange is where you meet with a native speaker of the language that you're trying to learn so that you can practice your speaking in exchange for them being able to practice the language that they're learning with you. At the end of this video, I'm going to tell you how you can find a practice partner to practice your speaking with. I'm also going to give you some advice on how to make it more fun and productive so that you get the most out of your time. Let's hit the intro.
Rose, ¿cómo estás? Me alegro de conocerte. Te voy a dar el saludo británico, que es el apretón de manos.
Rose has just arrived in the city, and I'm going to take her around the city centre. We're going to go check out some. We're going to go check out some of the things in the city, and I'm going to try and give Rose here a little bit of a tour around the place. ¿Cómo te sientes? ¿Tienes ganas de alegría, de ver y descubrir la ciudad?
Sí, it's very exciting.
Great. Bueno, vamos.
Shop Rose. Some of the things in this window have been there since I was about 5 years old. Probably longer. Look, we got the insects that look like they're really moving. And I've got the pretend chewing gum.
I'm gonna take Rose to Bob Carver's, which is the local chip shop, which has been there for like 125 years, so that she can try a whole patty, which is like the local delicacy, shall we say.
Have you had fish and chips in England yet, Rose? Have you tried fish and chips in England?
No.
Is this your first trip to a British fish and chips?
It's my first time.
How do you feel? Nervous? Excited?
I'm nervous for don't understand the waiters.
That's all part of the adventure. You get to try out your English and practice with native speakers.
I'm gonna help, don't worry. I've brought Rose to Bob Carver's in Hull to try the famous Hull patty, which is like a mixture, well, it's like deep fried mashed potato with a mixture of herbs, and this is like super super typical of Hull, and it's special in that you can't find it anywhere else in England, so you've really got to come to Hull to try one. The most typical thing is to eat it with chips. Like, I remember when I was a kid eating this with like chips, mushy peas, and a patty. Yeah, that's for like a patty meal. I'm not gonna do that today because I've already been really like overindulging in English food since I came back. But yeah, I really wanted Rose to try one of these because this is like, you know, it's something from my childhood. Anyway, enjoy before it goes cold.
It's very soft on the inside. This is a battered one. At this particular fish and chip shop, they have two varieties. They have one with breadcrumbs, or you can also get it with the battered variation. This is the most typical one. It's soft on the inside, battered on the outside. So what's the verdict?
Oh boy!
Wow, well, I'm honestly feeling a little bit overwhelmed. I wasn't expecting to see all this stuff going on in the city centre.
What do you you think of the English from Hull?
The English from Hull is very difficult for understand. The people eat the words and I don't understand nothing. But I don't understand me, it's okay.
Ross me ha dicho que todavía no ha visto el puente, así que estamos en el pier buscándolo.
¿Lo ves?
No.
Es muy guapo. Mira, está ahí. ¿Cómo que no lo ves?
Bueno, veo más o menos.
Está ahí mismo. Te voy a enseñar la ventana más pequeña de toda Inglaterra, pero primero tenemos que recordar dónde está, porque como es tan pequeña, ya no recuerdo dónde se encuentra. Bueno, dicen que está aquí en el George Hotel. Ahí está. The George Hotel, England's smallest window.
The George Hotel is one of Hull's oldest surviving public houses and can be dated back to 1683. It is also home to England's smallest window, which is rumoured to have been used in the days when the George was a coaching inn. A porter was seated at the window to watch for the coaches just to give immediate attention on arrival. So if you came in here with your horse and carriage, then there'd be a guy sat, or a lady perhaps, sat behind the window, and they could see as the horses came in so that you wouldn't be left sat outside waiting. What can you see in the window?
It's very little.
Not much.
Cuéntales la historia de cómo llegaste a Hull, porque me hace mucha gracia.
Ok, en un principio yo iba a venir con una amiga y pensábamos ir a Malta, que era más barato, ¿no? Pero qué pasa,
oh, perdón. Que... ¿Estás mirando al...? No, estás mirando aquí.
Estoy ahí, mirando
okay.
Ahí.
Tienes que me
dar aquí. Lo sé, todo el mundo me lo dice cada vez que me graban, pero ir a Malta era como irse a otra Mallorca, entonces dije, pues no, nos vamos al Reino Unido. Y yo soy muy fan de Escocia y quería ir a Escocia y mi amiga quería ir a York y tuvimos ahí una disputa, ¿no? Y al final ganó ella y dijimos, bueno, pues nos vamos a York. Pero eran muy caras las habitaciones en York, entonces así mirando en internet yo puse habitaciones en York y por lo visto Yorkshire es un condado que tiene muchas partes, lo cual nosotras no lo sabíamos. Y al poner habitaciones en York, que baratas, nal, me salió aquí una habitación en Hull y yo no me di cuenta y se la pasé a mi amiga y le dije, mira, esta habitación, ¿qué te parece? Y dice, pero esto no está en York. Y digo, sí, yo he puesto habitaciones en York. Y me dice, no, esto está en Hull. ¿Y qué es Hull? Pues no sé, y lo buscamos en el mapa. Y dijimos, ah, pues mira, esto es Hull. Y pues como era la más barata en realidad, pues vinimos aquí.
Es decir, es un accidente total, pero un accidente feliz.
Sí, estoy muy contenta. No sé cómo la gente no conoce Hull, porque tiene muchas cosas. Es muy interesante, tiene mucha historia. Historias sobre guerra, historias sobre personas que han hecho algo por primera vez, historias que han hecho algo por primera vez en la historia del Reino Unido, historias que han inventado, personas que han inventado algo, un montón de museos tiene y una arquitectura también muy bonita. Entonces yo no entiendo cómo no se conoce Hull, entonces estoy como súper sorprendida de no haber oído hablar nunca de Hull y aquí estoy súper happy.
The rain started coming down and I completely forgot to record an outro for the video, but anyway, let me tell you now how to organize a language exchange of your own. The easiest and most straightforward way is literally to go into Google and type language exchange plus the name of the city that you're currently living in. I've found a couple of language exchange partners in the past by doing just that. There are some dedicated sites online such as meetup.com, which is for groups of all different types. There's italki.com, which is an online portal of language teachers and language students where you can actually search their database for people that live in your area. Send a person a message directly and say, hey, I'm in your area. I saw that you're looking to learn my language. I can help you out. How would you feel about helping me to practice? And then arrange to meet the person in a public place like a cafe or something in a city center. And go from there. Let me tell you some of the things that you can do that will help you to get the most out of your language exchange. One thing that I strongly recommend you do is to take something that you've been learning to the exchange with you. This could be some notes that you've made, it could be a page of a textbook that you've struggled with, it could be some new words that you've found. This is an opportunity for you to put those words and structures into practice, and also to ask the other person for feedback and additional context to make sure that you've understood the thing that you've been learning. You'll always find that the other person is more than willing to help you out and to offer you additional advice to make sure that you've understood it. Second tip is no alcohol. There's a myth out there, quite a common myth, that if you drink alcohol, it makes it easier to speak a foreign language, or it somehow makes you better. This is completely false. Whilst alcohol has been branded like a social disinhibitor, the likelihood is that it's actually going to make you speak the language worse, and it could also make your new partner feel a bit uncomfortable as well. Another thing you want to consider doing is agreeing on the terms of the exchange with the person you're speaking with right at the start. By that I mean, how is it going to be a 50-50 split? Some people like to speak in their native language while the other person answers them in their language. Or you can also speak for 30 minutes in your language and then switch to the other language for 30 minutes. The reason you want to do this is that it can turn into a competition pretty easily if the other person is very eager to practice their language, but you also want to practice yours. And you don't want it to be a standoff. You're there to help one another. Speaking of which, you should really focus on adding value for the other person. Make sure that the other person has a good time and that they are learning, and in turn they will do the same for you. You're trying to build a relationship here and encourage the person to want to meet with you again so that you can continue practicing. And the best way to do this is to focus on adding value for them before you worry about value for yourself. You should also definitely give the other person permission to correct you or even interrupt you to offer you corrections. The whole purpose of you meeting up with this person is for you to practice your target language and to improve. If you don't get any corrections, you're not going to get the most benefit out of it, because we're generally so polite. We're very reluctant to interrupt another person or to tell them you're doing something wrong, because we don't want to make them feel bad. Tell them, if you hear me make a mistake, or if I use a wrong word or a wrong grammatical structure, please, will you correct me? Tell me what I'm doing wrong and tell me how to do it right. Normally, this is the advice that I would follow if I was meeting someone and the camera was off. I actually didn't follow much of my own advice today because I'm still figuring out how to make good YouTube videos, so trying to balance two languages at the same time as deciding like where to point the camera and trying to make sure that my exchange partner had a good time as we were walking around the city centre was a bit of a challenge. A question for you today is, how do you get to practice speaking in English? Put your answers in the comments below the video. This is the My English Teacher Rob channel, where we're all about helping you to become more fluent and confident in English. So if you've enjoyed this video and you've found it useful, hit the subscribe button and turn on the notifications so that you find out next time I upload some new content. Loads more good stuff coming for you soon. Thanks for watching. I'll see you again soon. Bye for now.